Hello, welcome everybody. Today I'm going to be talking about the one musical topic that every music fan in 2018 seems to be obsessed over, and that is the classic album conversation. What makes an album a classic? When can we define an album as a classic? And the importance that a classic album has to its specific genre. So first I want to define the three characteristics that I think define an album as a classic. And I feel like if an album doesn't have at least one of these three characteristics, then there's a very, very small chance that that album can even be considered a classic. So my first characteristic is influence. I think influence is easily the most important factor when it comes to deciding whether an album is classic or not. I think it's if you can see an album from its beginning grow over time, 10, 15 years, and influence how others made music, and you have constant artists saying, hey, this is what I went back to, this is what drove me to make this certain album, I think that's when you get into classic territory. The first album that comes to mind when it comes to this is Surfer Rosa by the Pixies, because Kurt Cobain constantly recited that album as one of the main influences when he made music for Nirvana. The song structure that the Pixies have, from being constantly mellow to quickly going back into very hardcore raw choruses, that formula was captured by a lot of bands during the 90s. And I feel like if you have Nirvana, who had a huge amount of influence on future bands and the way they made music, and even them were influenced by this specific album, it's one of the undenying factors that this is a classic album. And this is when I kind of start to touch on how I personally feel about labeling classic albums, in that it's a little bit objective. I know that most of the topics that we speak on when it comes to music are subjective. No one can tell you that you don't like an album. Nobody can tell you that an album is not good. But when it comes to classic albums, I feel like it's such an important term and label that it's a little bit objective, because even if you don't like a certain album, if you can see its growth, if you can see its influence and importance to a specific genre, you should be able to objectively say that's a classic album. And that kind of makes a classic album even more unique, because you kind of take the subjective part out of it, and even people that don't necessarily like an album or don't enjoy it can appreciate it under this term classic. My second characteristic when it comes to defining albums as classic or not is the uniqueness of an album. I feel like if an album is so different that it can't be replicated, it can't be touched, it can't be mimicked in any way, shape, or form without failure, then I think that's a classic album as well. And I think Operation Doomsday fits this example perfectly, because when Doom came out, his flow was so different, so unorthodox, so never before heard, that if any rapper tried to mimic what Doom was going for in that first album, they would have looked foolish. Not only is that flow so hard to capture and execute it well, if any person listens to someone that sounds in any way, shape, or form like Doom, they're gonna automatically go back to Doom, because that's the original, that is the essential example of set flow. Doom came out portraying this villainous character that very much intertwined with his own personal life, had very distinct concepts, and on top of that, such an unorthodox flow, that all of those different things being put together in one album, I think easily label it as a classic. And another reason why I find Operation Doomsday so important, even when it comes to solely classic albums, is because it touches on a topic that I feel is very crucial, especially in today's age. And that is that a lot of people feel as if you don't have a big enough fan base, you can't have a classic album. And I really don't understand that. And I think this aspect of being so different and so unique helps that, because even if you have 30,000 fans, even if you have 10,000 fans, it doesn't matter. If you make something so unique, so different, I think it can easily be labeled as a classic album. Another example of this would be the first Velvet Underground and Nico record, which when it initially came out was hated, it was ignored, it damn near looked like that album was gonna come and go and it was never gonna be talked about and just fall off the face of the earth. But we gave it time and critics went back to it, and now it's one of the most critically acclaimed albums, one of the most loved albums, and it's because we gave it time to grow. And even though the album was so different and it talked about topics that nobody else was talking about at the time and it strayed people away, it was so different that it felt the need to be come back to in the future, and that's what made the album a classic. And again, to bring up another point, when that album first came out, it only sold like 30,000 records, and it was a very small fan base. And this is a theme that kept going on with Velvet Underground's records. You know, they were hated initially, they didn't really sell well, but over time the music became timeless because of how different it was, because of how unique it was, how much it pushed a boundary. So if you give an album enough time, even in the 1960s when we had no internet and no constant discussions online about records, which made it easier for them to stay alive, that album stood the test of time simply based on the fact that it was so different and the quality was always there. And the third and last aspect to me that makes an album a classic is if it defined a set time period for a genre that would be crucial for its ongoing growth throughout time. And for example, to me, this would be like an Illmatic. When Illmatic came out, it defined New York / East Coast rap, which to this day is still a very important and talked about genre or subgenre in rap. Now, this doesn't mean that if a certain subgenre catches a little bit of popularity for a short amount of time, like said, the SoundCloud genre, even if a few rappers sort of created the subgenre and it had influence and some popularity, I feel like if it dies down like the SoundCloud genre, because I feel like the SoundCloud genre is already kind of dying down and I don't think it's going to stand the test of time, I wouldn't label those rappers to have classic albums, because those subgenres didn't impact the culture of rap the same way that East Coast rap or gangster rap or Southern rap music did. Those different subgenres in rap have become such a ingrained part of the culture that it will forever be timeless. When N.W.A. came out with Straight Outta Compton, that album literally popularized gangster rap. Ice-T might have invented it with Ryan Pace, but N.W.A. commercialized it, and it literally changed the way people lived their lives. People were influenced by the lyrics of MC Ren and Eazy-E and Ice Cube, and what they said on those records impacted how they lived their own lives and the way they went about their day-to-day activities. And I feel like once music impacts more than just music and affects life in itself and the way people live, I think that, again, is an undeniable classic. And gangster rap is still very prevalent today. You still have Freddie Gibbs and other rappers taking part in this subgenre, because the people that made music in the 80s, when the subgenre initially came out, it was good enough to stand the test of time. And I don't think that's something that's going to happen with the SoundCloud genre. Now, what needs to be kept in mind when it comes to classic albums, and this is something that the current youth doesn't really seem to understand, is the fact that you need to let these albums grow. You need to give them years upon years of time to see if they can stand the test of time, to see if they have influenced up-and-coming rappers, the future generation, in order to be labeled a classic. Nowadays, you have people calling albums classics days, weeks, months after they came out, and we've given it no time to grow, no time to settle. Like, what if an album you love the first few months is seems irrelevant in a few years and you don't really go back to it because it doesn't really sound that good? I always felt that when debating classic albums, we should be talking about albums that are 8, 10 plus years old, because that's a good enough time frame to define whether an album is a classic or not. Now, I understand that when it comes to my definitions of what a classic album is, there's a lot of objectivity in them. But I feel like even if an album is very different and very original, it has to have some form of a liking to at least some people in order to be recognized by the masses as a classic album. Because at the end of the day, classic albums are a testament to the music that gets remembered. And I feel like quality is what should be remembered most by each album. And a classic album, since it stands the test of time, it kind of shows people how to make music. So there definitely has to be some form of liking by a few people. And if that liking is very much recognized, it can then be recognized by others who kind of understand and see the impact that said album has on a particular audience of set genre, even if they personally don't think it's the greatest album ever or like a perfect album. For example, I think The Blueprint by Jay-Z is an undeniable classic because it kind of brought the soulful sound to rap, and Jay-Z was teaching people how to rap over soulful beats, and it kind of directed rap music forward to how people would make music in the 2000s. Now, I think that album is like a 7 out of 10. There's a few tracks that I don't like, but me, as a rap fan, I've seen the impact that it's had. I've seen the liking that other people have had towards it and the impact that have sat on other people's lives, so I can objectively say that The Blueprint is an undeniable classic, even if I don't think it's a 10 out of 10 perfect album. And this is why I love having actual conversations about classic albums, because it kind of throws away the bias that certain fans have when it comes to their favorite artists, and it kind of allows them to take a step back and see, hey, like, what was the most important influential music for set genre? And like, let's not take any favorites or my own personal likings, let's just have a conversation about the albums that, if they were never created in the first place, might have never given us the music that we all love today from our own personal favorite artists. So subjectivity is definitely what makes speaking about music so great, because nobody can tell you who the best is, nobody can tell you what you like and what you don't like. And I think that's what definitely brings people together and makes people want to speak about music. But I definitely think that a little bit of objectivity is definitely needed when speaking about certain topics within music.